Russell opens with the revelation that Dr. Anthony Fauci has presided for years over animal testing. Then he asks your opinion on the situation. Does this change your impression of Anthony Fauci? Then he points out how about 50% of Americans love Fauci and the other 50% hate him. Then he quotes Substack. The National Institution of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, the division of the National Institute of Health, run by Anthony Fauci, funded a recent experiment in Tunisia in which lab technicians placed sedated beagles' heads in mesh cages and allowed starved sandflies to feast on them alive. The experiment was just one of countless tests done on animals with funding of the NIH and of NIAID. In particular, over the course of decades, estimates of the number of animals experiment on each year in the United States range from the tens of millions to over 100 million, most of them paid for with taxpayer money. For the amount of money and the amount of suffering entailed, little is produced. Much of it is pointless to begin with. But even the experiments that purport to measure the safety and efficacy of drugs are all but useless. In NIH's own words, approximately 30% of promising medications have failed in human clinical trials because they are found to be toxic despite promising preclinical studies in animal models. About 60% of candidate drugs fail due to lack of efficacy. While reading these statements, Russell makes some commentary. What is the point? Why we don't see this in the news more regularly? His reasoning is because it's not an argument that the government can win if it is generally known by the public, because people generally do not agree with these kinds of treatments of animals. That's a 90% failure. Most of that failure is due to the fundamental differences between human physiology and the physiology of mice or rabbits or dogs. But even between animals with much closer physiologies, the predictive powers of animal tests is unimpressive. And yet, the tests continue unabated for three reasons. One, institutional inertia, basically meaning things tend to go the way they've always gone. NIH Director Francis Collins and Anthony Fauci, those are the three reasons. The other two reasons are Francis Collins and Anthony Fauci. The Tunisia experiment at least had some practical scientific value. Around 500,000 people a year get ZVL, many of them children, and they generally get it from dogs. The experiment showed that dogs that are infected by the parasite are more attractive to sandflies who carry the virus than uninfected dogs. The same can't be said for other experiments paid for by Fauci's NIAID. Last year, the Institute paid the University of Georgia $424,455 to infect beagles with parasites before killing them. The purpose of the experiment was to test a drug that, by the investigator's own admission, had already been extensively tested and confirmed in numerous other animal species. Then Russell makes some jokes to drive home how pointless and unnecessary these tests were. The NIH spends more than $40 billion a year on medical experiments. They are the principal source of funding for basic scientific research in America. The institutes estimate that 47% of their grants involve animal testing. Then he essentially points out that the real reason for these tests are just for funding, and if we would just stop letting the money dictate what we do, it wouldn't be necessary. It's likely that a percentage is much higher for NIAID alone. NIAID commands a budget of $6 billion. There's an unwritten rule that in order to win an NIAID grant, you have to test on animals. Almost all investigators are trained using animal research, said Jim Kane, a former USDA veterinarian and infectious disease specialist. If you don't use that model, you don't get funding. Then Russell pleads that morality should be at the heart of our systems rather than money. When a researcher submits an application for NIH funding, their proposal is reviewed in the first round by their peers, almost all of whom are animal testers. It's sort of incestuous, Dean said. According to Garrett Lavis, a former neuroscientist who used to experiment on mice and who has reviewed NIH grant applications, this professional insularity creates a culture of groupthink. You have institutional inertia
because of all of these animal experiments, he told me. It's simply taken for granted that a good research design entails animal experimentation, since everyone judging it has been trained that way. Keen, who was the whistleblower in a major New York Times expose of animal abuse at the U.S. Meat Animal Research Center in Nebraska, believes another reason for the animal-centric culture at NIH is its leadership, namely Fauci and Collins. People like Fauci and Collins really believe in that animal model, he said. It's a huge impact having those two at the helm. The two directors' unquestioning commitment to animal testing sets the tone for science as a whole. Careers are based on it, said Keen. Certainly Fauci's career is based on it. Fauci has been testing on animals for close to four decades and failing to produce results for just as long. The Fauci of the 80s at least had an excuse. Animal models may have been disastrous in terms of their predictive powers for humans, but it was arguably the best option scientists had at the time. In 2021, that isn't even remotely true. We have about 1,000 times more knowledge now than we had at the time we designed animal testing. Russell closes saying how he doesn't believe in unnecessary animal testing, but he wants to hear your thoughts, and I want to hear your thoughts in the comments below. Then he tells you to check out his podcast, Under the Skin, on Luminary, and to sign up to the mailing list, which I also have in the description below. And stay free.